Good evening, everyone. Good evening. One of the reasons why I say good evening more than once is because I never know when the stream is actually starting. So anyway, for those of you that haven't tuned in before, this is a daily occurrence. This is going to happen nightly, every single night at 8 p.m. Central Daylight Time. A different concert for you. Today actually is a little bit different. Today is actually going to be a full concerto, which does run roughly 17, 18 minutes. A little bit different than what I've been doing so far. I think what I'm going to do is once a week, I will set aside that time to do a larger masterwork. The Bach sonatas are really excellent. And this concerto that I'm playing tonight is one that is, well, I really enjoy it and I'm really looking forward to sharing it with you. First and foremost, just to let you know, I am broadcasting from Access Contemporary Music here in Chicago. It is rainy and gray and cold, but I don't know. I like rainy and gray. Anywho, just to let you know a little bit about ACM, ACM has existed as an entity since 2004. It was founded by Seth Bosted, who, if any of you are familiar with the show Relevant Tones on WFMT, which unfortunately no longer exists, but oh well. He has the rights to the name, which is good. Anyway, Seth Bosted founded Access Contemporary Music in 2004, and the school itself has been in existence since, he's gonna kill me. It's either 2007 or 2008. The organization has existed separately from, before the school for a number of years. Partnered with Open House Chicago, even doing events in Barcelona, Mexico City, New York, of course, and of course here in Chicago, Milwaukee. And one thing that we are waiting on is our Sound of Silent Film. This would have been our 15th year. In fact, our cellist, Allison Berger, has been in every single ACM concert since its inception, which is kind of amazing. So we're all waiting patiently for Sound of Silent Film to come back. Sound of Silent Film is, what we do is we solicit short subject silent films from all over the world. We even have had submissions from Iran, which is wonderful. And then we commission composers to write new scores for those films. And then those films are performed live with the score in the theater. We used to be at the Music Box, and now we're over at the Davis Theater in Lincoln Square. Anyway, here we are at ACM, and this is where I'm spending every day by myself, just to make sure that things are being kept up. All of our teachers are all around the city doing lessons online. Of course, I'm doing my lessons online, and I do them here as much as I possibly can. Just so you know, subscription is always optional. I'm never gonna beg anybody to subscribe. I'm just really glad that you're here. However, if you would like to subscribe and click the bell for reminders, you'll get reminders about my live stream starting, and it'd just be good to know who's watching and what kind of a community we can build. As I mentioned, this is going to be a longer live stream. I will do my best to keep my comments as brief as I possibly can, but I get distracted. I actually have, my friend Bill would be very proud of me. I have little notes right here, just sort of an outline on like what exactly I want to say. But anyway, so this piece that I'm playing tonight is Concerto in G major by Johann Quantz. And this is, as I mentioned, a piece that's really close to my heart. It's actually the first piece I learned when I was in college. Quantz is not really a name that folks outside of the flute world are really familiar with. but it's really familiar in flute circles because he really was the master of his day, about mid-18th century or so. But this is an example of what we would call classical music. Now, as musicians, this is forever a discussion we're having. It's, oh, do you play classical music? And that's a really hard question to answer because classical within the classical world is just one time period. We have medieval, we have Renaissance, we have Baroque, we have classical, we have Romantic, and on and on. And the way that you play, depending on the time period, it's going to change. There are certain things that you're going to do interpretively with trills, with vibrato, any way you play a piece. It's not very good to play a piece the same way, regardless of when it was written. You have to be a good steward of the composer's intention. And speaking of which, the flute that Quantz wrote for would have been very different than the metal one that I have in front of me. His flute would have been made out of wood, which would have given a much more mellow sound. My flute is a cylinder all the way through. It's all the same same circumference, whereas the classical flute would have tapered toward the end, once again giving it a smaller, sweeter sound. And also, the instrument required a lot less air to play than this one does. So phrasing in the classical period is a challenge. You really have to write in your breaths. But speaking of classical, well, I'm interrupting myself. This is an example of a piece of music that is written by a man who loved the flute, and it's obvious. This is why flutists love to play it. This is why I love to play it. However, sometimes we have to play pieces by composers who loathed the flute. For example, in the classical time period, the name that most people are familiar with is Mozart. So thorough was his loathing of the flute that when asked to write a second flute concerto, he took his oboe concerto and was like, all right, transposed, peace, done. And that is a piece that all of us have to learn, his second flute concerto in D. It's a great piece, but it was written by a man who really didn't like the flute at all. So when I started college, I'd mentioned that I'd done the second flute concerto, and my teacher just kind of went, Mozart does not know how to write slow movement. And which, well, that's up for debate. I'm not arguing. I'll let you guys do that. But Quantz, that slow movement in particular in this piece is really, really something. It's really, really gorgeous. I don't want to overcook the goose. Furthermore, speaking of being good stewards of a composer's intention, there are really two editions of this piece. There is the original edition, and then there's a modern edition. The flute that Quantz wrote for, the range was considerably truncated compared to this flute here. The flute that Quantz would have written for wouldn't have had all this business down at the end. So we've got, well, my flute has three semitones lower than what Quantz would have had. And also the modern flute has quite a bit more of an upper range. The Baroque flute, the classical flute, they could hit higher notes, but you couldn't fly around the way that we can. It was a much more unstable register, and the fingerings are weird. And it's not idiomatic to the flute. And so there are modern editions that take parts of Quantz's concerto up the octave to make it more like maybe what he would have done had he written it today. But I'm more interested in playing the piece as it was written. And I mean, of course, people could say, oh, well, he probably would have written it this way had he lived in this time period. And of course, well, if my grandmother had wheels, she'd be a bike. So I'm really much more interested in playing it as it was written. And by the way, I have a nasty habit of everything I say sounds like I'm like taking a moral stance or throwing shade. I'm not throwing shade at all. My interpretation is not superior to anyone else's. This is a choice I've made. I listened to both versions. I had learned the original, rather, I'd learned the modern version, and then my teacher played me a recording of the historical ranges, and I was like, yeah, that's what I want. So that's what I'm going to play today. I think I've talked enough. Just really, really fast, though. Fun game to play in the chat. So this is a multi-movement piece. There are three movements in this piece. Now, the nice thing is all of you are at home. Get yourself comfortable. And we don't have to worry about whether or not there's going to be that one person who goes in between movements. But I'm curious because I don't think that... My understanding is this idea of not applauding in between movements, I think, is a fairly recent one and tends to be localized. Like, I know American audiences typically don't, but I think in Italy, I'm really not very educated on this subject, and I don't know what I feel about it anymore. I used to be in the don't applaud camp because you want to applaud the work as a whole, but I can absolutely understand wanting to applaud in between movements. As a performer, shoot, like if you get finished with a real banger of a movement, it's really nice to get some applause. So I'm curious, what do you think? Do you think we should hold our applause to the end, or do you think we should applaud when we feel like applauding? So anyway, I think I've talked enough. So those of you with perfect pitch, I'm already going to apologize to you. This is a European string orchestra, so this is actually going to be A442. I'm not making excuses. because I play a metal instrument and I'm not running the heat in this school right now, it is very cold in here. And when metal gets cold, it goes really, really flat. So I'm going to do everything I can to keep my pitch up for you. So if you're going to see me doing a lot of this to just keep my pitch up. So I'm going to do my best. That's all I can do. So anyway, like I said, I've talked enough. Let's do this thing.
Thank you.
you applauded just now, you should identify yourself in the comments. I really want to know. Thank you very much for tuning in. This is just a treat and a delight to be able to do this. And I'm so glad that you're here. Oh, we're every day, shoot, there's always gonna be some kind of, there we go. All right, so, gosh, I was gonna say something pithy and erudite and I've completely forgotten. To reiterate, I'm really curious about what your thoughts on the whole applause issue is. I'm going to be back, of course, tomorrow at 8 Central Daylight Time. Please tune in. And of course, these videos are going to stay up afterward. You don't necessarily have to tune in at that time, although it'd be lovely to have you. This is kind of an amazing experience for me because even though I'm looking at a screen right now, there's just something about the live element. This is live music. I legit have like two speakers that are next to my mics down here. And I don't have the most sophisticated equipment, but I'm really, really happy that I can do this. And actually a big reason why I'm able to do this is because of the website flutebackings.com. This is not a sponsored post. How I'm able to get these backing tracks, like the one last night, that was one that I recorded myself. It's not always gonna be one that I have to go out and find. But how cool is it that I get to play the Quantz Concerto with the instruments it was written for? That is a live string orchestra. It's not a piano reduction. This is really, really fantastic. And there is so much more. In fact, to be perfectly honest with you, the way that I'm choosing these programs is like related to like what's on their website. I mean, it's not as bad as all that. But spoiler, tomorrow night, if you've ever seen the movie True Lies, you're going to really enjoy the one, that I'm playing tomorrow. Anyway, and it's not going to be anywhere near this long. And if you've stuck with me this long, thank you. This has just been a treat to be able to share this with you. And if you liked what you saw and you feel like subscribing, please do. And be sure to click on the bell to get reminders. But as I say, it's completely your option. And I'm just really glad that you're here. So I look forward to seeing you tomorrow.